The Kalahari is a wondrous place where little children's clear, innocent, big brown eyes mirror the night sky. A land where lions roam free and where giraffes tower over the steppe and human frivolities. This is also the realm where words imitate the language of heartbeats and raindrops. I went to the Kalahari to build wells and friendships and to speak words of hope to the Khoisan people. While there, I was gifted much, an appreciation for what constitutes real needs, a renewed understanding of humanity, and malaria. You see, Africa is generous that way. I also learned that life is a privilege and it ought to be lived right. Life is never stagnant. It moves, it changes, it transforms. And one of the most powerful driving forces is spirituality, the thrust for meaning and purpose. The interpreter of beauty, trust, and longing. I was 23 when I was first caressed by the desert sun. Far from all that was familiar and surrounded by limitless wonder, I stepped into a world completely foreign to my European sensitivities and biases. Why did I go? What led me there? What compelled me to venture into the unknown and reach out to a people and world full of mystery and awe? Simply put, I was spurred on by a spirit of adventure and my love for travel. And I was moved by my faith. Let's talk about the letter. Faith. What shapes our convictions? We live in a pluralistic world marked by diversity, where traditional ideas spawn dissonant tones, where globalization has disenfranchised ideologies, the internet has compressed distance and time, and access to information is virtually instant. Among this overabundance of options, there are multitudes of articulate, argumentative, and apparently persuasive voices which challenge the faith paradigm. Moreover, they question whether religion, faith's vehicle, is still relevant, trustworthy, and beneficial to humanity's welfare and progress. Why talk about faith? Should we still be burdened by such conversations? Well, our convictions form our worldview, that which helps us make sense of it all. As author and neuroscientist Sam Harris writes, our beliefs define our vision of the world. They dictate our behavior. They determine our emotional response to other human beings. So, talking about faith is important for our own sanity and the well-being of our neighbor. Also, our worldview, our inner conceptual framework, seeks to offer answers to foundational questions on origin, meaning, morality, and purpose. These answers need to be rational, correspondingly true, and as a whole, coherent. We do not live in a vacuum. We are constantly informed and educated, sometimes without even being aware that we are. Entertainment, television programs, social media, books, travel, and casual conversations fashion our thinking. At school, children and young people are taught the scientific model of reality and life, while cultural events, the home, and religious rites provide additional sources for our formation as human beings. The problem is that often the information acquired is in conflict, and so it needs to be unpacked, analyzed, critiqued, explained, and contextualized. This is a matter of inner congruence and mental stability. So, what is faith? At the end of the 20th century, sociologist Peter Berger predicted that faith would diminish in the public sphere and become privatized. Later on, Sam Harris proclaimed the death of faith. However, the reality is that we are currently witnessing a resurgence of religious fervor, a fact recognized by Berger himself and affirmed by the likes of Jonathan Sacks, who celebrates the persistence of faith. Faith is different things to different people. Richard Dawkins calls it the great cop-out, the great excuse to evade the need to think and evaluate evidence. And while Christopher Hitchens qualifies religion with displeasure, ineradicable, Harris interjects and states that religious faith represents so uncompromising a misuse of the power of our minds that it forms a kind of perverse cultural singularity, a vanishing point beyond which rational discourse proves impossible. Is faith irrational then? Not long ago, I saw a church sign which read, "Reason is the greatest enemy that faith has." Does that mean that faith and reason cannot coexist? It is believed that Mahatma Gandhi once said, "Faith must be enforced by reason. For when faith becomes blind, it dies." This view is also held by most religious apologists, who regard faith to be trust in God because God has shown oneself to be reliable and trustworthy. Moreover, generations of religious scholars, from Augustine to C.S. Lewis to N.T. Wright, have written numerous books defending and explaining religious faith. And this is why most believers strongly maintain that faith is not belief in spite of the evidence, but belief in the light of the evidence. Historically speaking, the apparent enmity between reason and faith in Western thought began with Thomas Aquinas' theology, in which he argued that human reason can establish the existence of God. He also held that though humans fell, disobeyed, rebelled against God in Eden, their intellect did not. This idea led to the creation of a system in philosophy that argued that one's reason was autonomous, meaning that it was free and independent of any constraint. This further opened the door to later thinkers building philosophical arguments independent of the idea of God. Here is another question. Do all people possess the gift of faith? In Dan Brown's Angels and Demons, Harvard symbologist Robert Langdon has an intriguing conversation with the papal Camerlengo.
Christianity's most sacred codices are in that archive. Given your recent entanglement with the Church, there is a question I'd like to ask you first here in the office of His Holiness. Do you believe in God, sir?
Father, I simply believe that religion...
I did not ask if you believe what man says about God. I asked if you believe in God.
I'm an academic. My mind tells me I will never understand God.
And your heart?
Tells me I'm not meant to. Faith is a gift that I have yet to receive.
Faith is a gift that I have yet to receive, says Professor Langdon. Some people quote the Bible in support of this idea. For it is by grace you have been saved, through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God. They interpret it to refer to faith instead of grace as being the gift. One more question. Is faith a choice? Here is a tale of two brothers. When they were very young, these two boys didn't really get along. In their teenage years, they both went through a rebellious phase and turned against religion, even burning their Bible. Their crisis of faith was compounded by their mother having an affair with a lay clergyman. And then there was the psychological torture they speak of, caused by a painting in their home concerning the Last Judgment. The two boys grew up and both went to Russia, where they witnessed the evils of communism. This is the story of Christopher and Peter Hitchens. In The Rage Against God, How Atheism Led Me to God, Peter writes, as he, Christopher, has become more certain about the non-existence of God, I have become more certain that we cannot know such a thing in the way that we know anything else, and so must choose whether to believe in God or not. So, is faith rational? Is it a gift? Is it a choice? Science tells us that faith is an expression of psychological constructs, a function of our psychological nature. Let's explore, then, the psychological approach. Freud sees faith as a need grounded in the father figure image, while Jung regards God to be an image of our self. Jeremy Sherman contextualizes faith within the means of communication and regards it to be a power word, or, as he calls it, a limiting word. The ultimate way to stop wondering. Or is it? Speaking on faith and reason, Bruce Hood, an experimental psychologist who specializes in developmental cognitive neuroscience, states that humans are actually not rational creatures, And it is this innate irrationality which leads to religion and superstition. Hood further suggests that supernatural beliefs are hardwired into our brains from birth, and that religions are therefore tapping into a powerful psychological force. Jesse Bering, an evolutionary psychologist, agrees with Hood and proposes that the religious reflex is not an irrational aberration, and that God is not a cultural invention or an existential band-aid, but an intrinsic human trait. And after extensive research on near-death experiences, Kevin Nelson, professor of neurology, concludes that faith is an impulse and spiritual experience is an incidental product of several different neurological processes acting independently. And then there is Andrew Newberg, a neuroscientist and professor of religious studies, who, after rigorous brain imaging of nuns during prayer and of Buddhist monks during meditation and other religious practices, highlights that religious impulse is rooted in the biology of the human brain. In other words, religion is not a neurological illusion, but rather the concept of God is, once again, hardwired in our brain. This fact was attested to by Professor Lawrence Krauss, a theoretical physicist who, during a debate on faith and science, conceded that humans are wired to believe and that scientists need to fight against it in order to remain objective. So, what is the evidence of faith? Scientific research seems to show that faith is innate, persistent, and natural to humans. That we are biologically hardwired to believe. Faith is not a gift possessed by a select few or a choice, but rather religious faith is an inherent quality of all our minds. Its essence lives and breathes within us, and rationally reaches beyond mere reason. Simply put, faith is. We may choose how to exercise faith and where to place it or misplace it. In this series, I invite you to consider the options.